episode. So, hello, everybody. Welcome to today's ALLI-Gator Academy workshop. The ALLI-Gator Academy, the Applied Lifelong Learning and Information Gator Academy, is a series of workshops on important life skills that you may not have learned in school. We have many interesting workshop topics coming up. Topics include mental health, personal finance, healthy cooking, and important legal documents, and that is just this semester. Workshops are held every other Friday during the fall semester at 12 noon Eastern time. This presentation is being recorded. So today's topic is fostering mindfulness in classroom communication. Our presenter is Dr. Carolyn Stevenson. Dr. Carolyn Stevenson is currently a full-time faculty member for Eastern Gateway Community College. She teaches speech and interpersonal communications. She completed her EdD from Roosevelt University, MBA from Kaplan University, MA in Communication from Governor State University, and BA in English from Northern Illinois University. She has over 20 years teaching and administrative experience in higher education at both the undergrad and graduate levels. Thank you, Carolyn.
Thank you so much. And I'm going to share my screen and we will get started with our presentation. Thank you all for joining today. And what we're going to look at is ways to foster mindfulness in classroom communication. So professional communication does foster a sense of engaged learning. And to create that engaged learning community, it's important to really recognize life challenges, ways that we can manage unexpected things that happen. And using mindfulness is a great tool for helping us really navigate through many of our uncertain times. So we're going to look at communication, mindfulness, setting the tone and the atmosphere in your classroom and working with your faculty, and establishing a positive work-life goal through some SMART goal settings. So it's really important to think about communication, and communication has two major aspects, oral communication and written communication. So when we're thinking about how do we best communicate in our classrooms, in the discussion board, responding to emails, we want to remember that it's important to be very clear, add value, be accurate, and be relevant. So when you're sending an email to your instructor with a question about an assignment, for example, think about, again, very concise. Faculty oftentimes get a lot of email, and the clearer you are, the quicker the response you will get. So really, instead of rapid firing responses off your phone, you know, or other mobile device, take time before you hit that send to really read it over, read the email out loud and see if it makes sense. You'll get a quicker response and more information as well. So what else is involved? Well, we're going to look at clear and concise communication. That really involves meaningful responses, creating self-awareness in communication, our written communication and our verbal communication as well. Now, the concept of mindfulness has really, I think, taken center stage during the past year in the terms of thinking about what is self-awareness, how do we create a sense of being fully present, and with all of the things that are going on in the world, coupled with the fact that going to college, balancing your work, your life, all of these issues, we don't take time often for ourselves. And so what does it mean to be mindful? Well, being mindful is not a substitute for actually participating in our lives and taking care of our own and others' needs. In fact, it's the more mindful we are, the more skillful we can be in compassionate action. And the graphic here has a reference, and the references are also included at the end of the slide deck, that will help you practice, put, you know, theories into practice for being mindful. So take a few moments every day to clear your mind and create a very healthy work-life balance. And meditation is one way. And meditation can take on many definitions. It could be taking it off into a, you know, a whole sort of focus and, lifestyle. But meditation can also be just 3 minutes a day where you become calm, you breathe naturally, and you clear your mind of all of the stressors that are going on. And it really does help to create a very peaceful mindset. So then you can go back, focus on your classes, focus on the task at hand. And so we can practice really quickly. I am not a guru at all, but I do spend the first few moments of the morning, just 3 minutes, grounding myself and setting an intention so I can fully be present in my work. And so what you want to do is begin by sitting in a very comfortable position. It can be on a chair, a mat, a couch, whatever is very comfortable for you. Now close your eyes. Take the focus away from everything you hear in your outside world. Breathe naturally. Simply let the air flow naturally in. Be conscious of your breath. Now, let's set an intention. Whatever you are thankful for or whatever you choose to work on for that day. For example, gratitude. Think about the things that you feel gratitude for. What are you thankful for? Reflect. Open your eyes and use and set that intention throughout the day. So the other sort of way to practice is just to be conscious of your breathing. Slow down. We live in such a hectic world. Everything related to social media, driving your kids around, working, school, assignments, discussions, oh my. We don't take time to actually breathe. And so this link here is a very short YouTube video on mindful breathing. And you can think about it as rain. Recognize what's going on. Allow the experience to be there just as it is. Investigate with kindness and create natural awareness, which really comes from within and not without. So what does it mean to have mindful responses in your classroom? Let's take the theory and the concepts related to mindfulness and self-awareness and put that into your role as a student. So thinking about, again, email to instructor should be professional. Make sure the subject line is clear. Assistance on module 2 speech. That will grab the attention of your faculty member so they know exactly how to prioritize their inbox. Think about your own inbox. That concept of putting yourself in somebody else's shoes is a communication concept called dual perspective. So it's not saying that you have to live the life of another person, but understand if you can put yourself in that situation, or how do you feel when you open your EGC email and there's, you know, 1,000 different emails in there, and the subject lines, if they are vague, you're not going to read them right away. So you want to make sure you get the attention of your faculty member with a clear subject line. Empower yourself too. Don't forget that EGC has a wealth of resources, everything from writing help to life skills, like the ALLI-Gator Academy workshops, will help you not only do well in your classes, which of course is the reason why you're here, but it helps you do well in life. It creates a more balanced experience. When you're working on your assignments and your discussion responses, if you're an online student, read things thoroughly. We have a tendency, I think, as a society, if it's not, a tweet, we don't read the whole assignment. Oftentimes with embedded within assignments or handouts that you're given in class are very explicit directions to help you succeed. The other key thing is look at the rubrics for the assignments. The rubric is the roadmap your faculty member will be using to grade those assignments. And for online students, your discussion responses. Take a look. It's a checklist. It's very transparent. There's not sort of a random assignment of grades. Look at those rubrics and be aware of your own personal and professional stressors. What causes you to get stressed out? Keep a journal, write things down. And when you're feeling that high level of stress, because you have an assignment due, you have to give a speech, you have to write a business plan, your child is sick, you're sick, you got to walk your dog, all of these things happening all at once, slow down, take it one step at a time. And so self-awareness in communication relies on your authenticity. Be yourself and let your voice be heard. Use the college resources for personal challenges as well. There's a wealth of information. When you log into your student portal, you'll see a wealth of information. Communicate challenges with faculty. Let your faculty member know if something has come up. Be mindful also of HIPAA and other FERPA legal things related to privacy though. So don't disclose all the details if you're ill or, you know, keep things vague in the sense that you don't want to go into elaborate details. Just let them know you have a family situation, you may be late. Faculty are willing to work with you. Let them know and communicate. People don't know what's going on unless if you need more time, you know, ask. So also never send an email or respond if you're an online student on a discussion board when you have a high level of stress, that will reflect it as well. Slow down and practice that dual perspective. So this video that's embedded in here, I'm not sure if it's going to play. I don't think it will, but do take it's a self-awareness video and it actually does illustrate a number of ways that we really miss a lot of subtle information. So if you have some time, this presentation will be accessible. The link will be in the PowerPoint. Take a look at it as well. So there are basically 7 C's of effective communication. So be complete, coherent, concise, concrete, considerate, correct, and courteous in your written communication. In your verbal communication, remember to effectively listen. That noise is hearing. Listening takes effort. You have to be fully engaged. It takes a lot of practice because there's internal noise, things that we're worried about, stressors in our head, external noise, you know, the sound of animals barking or fire trucks or whatever your environment is like. So it does take a lot of effort. When you're listening in a face-to-face classroom, think about ways when your mind starts to wander, how to draw it back in. Sometimes it's good to take notes, pull yourself back in. When you are in an online class and there's a Zoom session or a recorded video, allow yourself time to fully focus. Watch your body language when you're in these sort of open office hours or seminars. When you're in the classroom, actively look like you're paying attention because you will then. So if you're all kind of slouched over, you know, hand is holding up your chin, that shows to the faculty member you're not interested, and to your peers as well. People look at you. You may not realize that you are a role model for your peers, for your community. So think about your body language as well. Make sure you're using your professional identity. Display empathy. Understand that if you email your faculty member at 2:00 in the morning, you're most likely not going to get a response. Basic needs such as sleeping and eating fall upon all human beings, regardless of role in the educational system. Also keep silent when others are speaking, and do as you say, meaning when your assignments are due, get them in on time. And if there's an issue, communicate that as well. So mindfulness is that awareness cultivated by paying attention in a sustained and particular way on purpose in the present moment and non-judgmental. We all have views, voices should be heard, but you know, it's important to really think about ways that we can be objective. It doesn't mean that you have to agree with what people are saying in a discussion, but you can hear their voice. Empathize, putting yourself in somebody else's shoes. Proactively communicate. For example, if there is a life challenge, let your faculty know that something's going on. You might be ill, or you have extra responsibilities at work, and express that, because most likely people are willing to work with you. And the individual communication can happen with your classmates in the face-to-face environment. It can just be making that connection, exchanging an email, and helping each other out, prepare for an exam. In the online situation, it's also, you can create a strong, realistic connection by just reaching out to people. So if you kind of still have some questions, or you're not fully sold on this, some of the benefits of mindfulness are clarity, fairness, understanding, learning retention, flexibility, and adaptation. So we want to think about ways that we can create a positive environment and an atmosphere in both our personal and our professional lives. You can take these tips and put it into your own home setting too. Acknowledge stress. It is part of our life. When you feel like you are just extremely busy, you don't even know where to go, take that moment, take a breath, and slow down. Think about how an atmosphere is created in an online classroom, and it's through your verbal communication, through, for example, videos. It's also through written communication, tone and attitude. You can hear that, you can feel that in written responses, and be supportive of other students as well. So again, a few tips on creating that positive atmosphere and tone in the classroom. Read the instructor feedback on your assignments. This is so important. I teach speech and interpersonal communication, and in addition to using the rubric and which outlines how the learners are going to be graded, you want to read my feedback too. Read your instructor feedback. They will oftentimes give you great suggestions on improvement. And improvement is not criticism of your work. We always have room for improvement. In my writing, I've written a few books on anything from environmental education to technical communication. I always take into consideration my comments from my writing team. I might think it's so close, it's so personal, our assignments. These are things that we're putting out there. We're giving our heart and soul into it. And someone says, oh, I think that's too much information, or you need more information. Don't take that personally. Take it as an outlet for improvement. And use that feedback from your instructor to improve upon with those future assignments. When you're in an online classroom, personalize discussion posts to demonstrate your expertise. Respond to the questions supported with academic sources, but maybe you have a little narrative you want to share as well. And if there's office hours and you have questions on campus, make sure you use them. The same is true for virtual office hours as well. So we're really, you know, speaking about, you know, that classroom presence, create the connections, plan ahead, use the calendar in Canvas, be clear in your written and verbal communication, look at your instructor feedback, and engage. Really put yourself, when you're in class, when you're in your online class, That's what you're doing. You are a student. In your personal world and all the roles you play, be fully present, one step at a time, one thing at a time. Multitasking is actually something that is not necessarily a strength, because oftentimes, are you really doing everything effectively, or are you doing two things sort of ineffectively? One of the tools that can help you organize things, it's called SMART goals. And SMART goal setting helps plan things out. You want to make sure that your goals are specific, very simple, sensible, and significant, measurable. Okay, so how do you measure what goals you set? And that's through creating meaningful and motivating goals, achievable, that it's something that you can do. Don't set your goals too high. For example, I'm going to finish all of my school in the next 2 years, master's, doctorate, everything. That's unrealistic. Set goals that are realistic to you. You know, on Thursday night, I will complete a draft of my English paper. On Friday, I will review and revise. Okay, keeping it one step at a time. Make sure the goals are relevant and time-bound too, that things are time sensitive in our you know, weekly assignments. Those are due every week. So use the goals and the setting of goals to help organize your life. This is really kind of a cool template. It's very simple. The source right here, you can just pull that up and it creates a template for you to fill out. So I know that no one has time to actually goal set, but it will save you a lot of time later on down the road and save you a lot of stress too, because then you can go back and say, okay, what is it I'm planning to do this week? What is top priority, or what I also consider to be non-negotiable? And this will help plan and make your life a lot more organized and a lot more manageable. So when life events come up, you're prepared. So I thank you all for attending today. Feel free to reach out with any types of questions, you know, that you have. The references are in the PowerPoint deck, so you can always go back and pull up these links, watch the video. And again, thank you for attending. There's a short survey that you can complete. We welcome your feedback, and I thank you all for your time today.
Thank you very much. Excuse me. Thank you very much, Carolyn. Does anyone have any questions? So the one question I had for you, Dr. Stevenson, is on slide 12 under verbal communication, it said show your personal identity. And I was just wondering what that means.
That's a great question. Thank you for asking that. Your personal identity can be found through using your voice in the classroom. For example, you might be sitting there listening to your instructor go through their lecture, and something comes to mind like, that doesn't relate to me. For example, if the topic is something on time management, and you might be working two jobs, you might be a single parent, you might have multiple children, and carving out time, you know, at 6 o'clock in the morning, you might say, well, how does that work for me? Because I don't have enough time right now in addition to school. So you raise your hand and let your experiences be heard as well. Mm-hmm. So it becomes you then can relate better. Just because you're hearing something in a lecture or reading something in a textbook, how often, you know, I personally find that too. I'm like, this doesn't relate to me. When I hear about hurricanes, well, I live in the city of Chicago. We don't have that issue. Mm-hmm. But as a faculty member, my students in speech will say, Ida came through. You know what? I don't know what a hurricane looks like, but I do empathize. Empathy. Okay, I see the pictures. So yes, you can have extra time for your assignments. Be safe. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And also in your writing, be authentic, let your voice be heard, mm-hmm. in the sense that you're keeping a level of professionalism But don't think that you can't ask a question by raising your hand in class or posting something in your online classes. So
Okay, thank you. Okay. Well, yeah, so like Dr. Stevenson was saying at the end of the presentation, there is a brief survey. If you'd like to fill that out, you will be entered into a prize drawing. So thank you, Dr. Stevenson. I think we'll stop the recording now. And I hope you all have a wonderful weekend.
Thank you.